Good afternoon, everyone. If you can hear me, say hello. Thank you. Hi, everyone. Did you know that UCSF had a sport team? You didn't know that? This is a celebration of a marathon. It's not your marathon. You are just the spectators, but ask them about it. So we're just going to start by asking all the Grad Slam participants to stand up so that we can recognize you. I love it. They're just back there having a good old time. Thank you very much. You'll hear from them momentarily. Let me see if I can get through my piece quickly so that the real show can begin. As you can tell, I'm really excited that you're here and you're sharing this event with your friends and your colleagues. And we have about, last check, there were about 40-something people online. Traditionally, you have hundreds of people that look at this afterwards. So this is going to be a fantastic. Now, this is my third year doing it, and this is the fullest the room has been. And I've seen some of the stuff that's going on already, so I can't wait. So let's go. As many of you know, UCSF sits on a holy land, and we like to recognize that before we start. So as we gather here in person on our campus in San Francisco, we want to acknowledge the Ramaytush Ohlone people who are the traditional custodians of this land. We pay our respects to the Ramaytush elders, past, present, and future, who call this place the land that UCSF sits upon their home. We are proud to continue their tradition of coming together and growing as a community. We thank the Ramaytush Ohlone community for their stewardship and support, and we look forward to strengthening our ties as we continue our relationship of mutual respect and understanding. So for those of you who, let me just see, those of you, this is your first time at a Grad Slam. Well, a lot of newbies. All right. Wait, some of our contestants, it's their first time too. This is so awesome. All right. Many of you, those of you who this is not your first time, Grad Slam is really part of what we call Grad Student Appreciation Week. This is a national week of observation for our grad students who we recognize that you are a critical part of the research ecosystem here at UCSF and across the country, in fact, across the world. So, in honor of, first of all, how many of you have been to events this week? How many of you have t-shirts this week? Okay, haven't been to the event, but have t-shirts, that's all right. There, for those of you who are grad students who have not had t-shirts, you can still get them. I see Tanya right here, raise your hand, Tanya. She's sitting right up front. And if you see Eric, most of you know who Eric is. If you see Eric or even Mary, these are people that you know, just go talk to them. You can get a t-shirt. We really want you to have these t-shirts, okay? Excuse me. All right, if you're a grad student, can you just stand? If you're a grad student. Yes, yes, yes. All right, if you're sitting or, no, keep standing. If you're sitting or standing in the vicinity of a grad student, can you just give them a high five and say, I appreciate you. Can you just do that? Yes. All right. All right. Thank you very much. All right. I hope you all feel appreciated. For those of you who are standing, there are a bunch of seats up here if you want. Lots of fill-in spaces that you can come down and sit. If there's a seat next to you, please raise your hand. If there's a seat next to you, just raise your hand. Look, there you go. I'm sorry. If there's an open seat, my fault. I love you guys. I got to tell you, I love you guys. All right. Grad Slam is first and foremost for the benefit of our PhD students. We hope that the skills the students have acquired in preparing and practicing to give their talks today and the poise with which they have gained from engaging in this challenging communication exercise will serve them well no matter where their career path takes them. The past few years, we have only reinforced that it's really important for scientists to be able to make their often complex and specialized work accessible to a broad public. Grad Slam also benefits the rest of us because we get a glimpse, and this is why it's so exciting for me every year, into the fascinating and important research that our students all across UCSF engage in every day. So thank you to the finalists. Thank you very much. For all your efforts to make your research accessible to a broad audience and to helping the graduate division to highlight the accomplishment and the vitality of our graduate programs. And now, introducing your MC today, the amazing, the immutable, the one and only Triple D. Ladies and gentlemen, help me welcome Dr. Deanne Duncan, the assistant dean.
What's up? Okay, great. We're gonna have a fun day today. I have my script. You know how I do. I go off script sometimes, so we're just gonna have a good time today. So, and thank you, Dean Blake, for the warm introduction. I appreciate it. All right, let me turn my page. I'm on the wrong page. See, I'm already starting right now. All right, so today you'll hear from 10 of our over 1,000 PhD students. You didn't even know we had 1,000 PhD students, did you? Exactly. PhD candidates entered the Grad Slam contest by submitting their talks on video in a group of screening judges comprising of faculty, staff, and alums, review the videos to choose these 10 finalists. These students have been working very hard to make their talks very as engaging as possible for you today. Of course, the prize money at stake does not hurt. For the competition, the grand prize, $4,000. I know, that's like rent and some bills, right? The second place prize is $2,000. That's just bills. Maybe the car note if you have a car. The third place prize is $1,000. That's just bills and maybe some shoes, right? So plus you, the live and remote audience, will decide the People's Choice Award, which is worth $750 dinner for the weekend, right? So I know we live in San Francisco, so I'm glad you're getting the humor, right, with the prize money. But the prize money is pretty sweet. You will have a few minutes to cast your vote online once all of the finalists have given their presentations. And this year, we have a new recognition. To the remaining finalists who are not awarded one of the cash prizes, they will receive a $100 Amazon gift prize. So everybody gets money. So the other way the in-person audience can participate today is the trivia contest. Between each speaker, I'll ask all of you a question, and the live audience member who gets it correct will win a small prize. Again, prize upon prize upon prize. I know you are anxious to hear the students' talks, but before we get started with the presentations, I want to introduce you to our very impressive panel of judges. Judges, would you please each stand as I introduce you? Thank you. Aaron Alday is a reporter for the San Francisco Chronicle. After years covering health topics, she currently focuses on gender and sexuality. Aaron previously joined us as a judge a few years ago, so we're happy to have you back. Thank you for being here. And I just need to adjust for one moment up here. Okay. The next judge is Rainey Chang, director of the Meteorology and Measurement Division of the Bay Area Air Quality Management District, and a graduate of UCSF Biological and Medical Informatics PhD program. She's also a past board member of the Graduate Division Alumni Association. Thank you for being here. Next, we have Brian Finn, a 2007 graduate of the Chemistry and Chemical Biology PhD program and is a principal investigator at Calico's Life Sciences and a current board member of the Graduate Division Alumni Association. Welcome. Next, we have Kristen Hartnett, and she is a professor of social and behavioral sciences at UCSF and the director of the sociology PhD program. Welcome. And last, we have Laura Pearson, who is a postdoc in UCSF's Department of Cell and Tissue Biology, working in the lab of mentor Noel Letitoul. Laura was also the first prize winner of UCSF's 2023 Postdoc Slam competition, where she introduced us to the concept of the Warnado. Welcome, thank you. So thank you so much, judges, for being here and for taking your time to carefully consider and choosing our grand prize winner for Grad Slam this weekend. So thank you so much. The judges will be looking for these basic qualities in the presentations. The first point is, did the presentation help you understand the research? Second, was the topic and its significance communicated using language appropriate to an educated but non-specialist audience? And lastly, did the presentation make you want to know more about the research? That's the money one. Each talk will be timed, and any presentation that goes over 3 minutes will be disqualified. I know. I heard the gasp. By the way, our official timer is the UCSF Registrar, Doug Carlson. Doug is an official timekeeper for the Cal football and basketball games. He spots down the downs and yards to go for the scoreboard operator at the 49ers games, and he operated the game clock for the NCAA West Regionals in 2022. So we got an expert in our midst. So before we get started, I gotta give you some etiquette. Please silence your cell phones. I know a lot of you on Twitter. I got off Twitter, but I know you're on Twitter. No, we're not doing that right now. Do it afterwards. We don't want anything to distract the students as they deliver their talks. So also no talking, texting, or flash photography during the student presentations. Now, judges, are you ready? Okay. Finalists, are we ready in the back? Audience, are we ready? Let's get it started. So the finalists drew numbers to determine the order in which they will speak. Our first speaker is Chad Altobelli. He is in the Chemistry and Chemical Biology PhD program. His faculty advisor is Dr. Michelle Arkin, and the title of his talk is Sizing Up Drug Candidates with a Molecular Ruler.
The low rider is a little higher.
The microscopic scale of life is almost incomprehensible. Cells are impossible to see with the naked eye, yet within each one is over 40 million tiny structures called proteins. Each of these is a fuzzy bundle of atoms, vibrating and jostling in a thick soup. Most proteins in cells are structural and simply hold things together. They organize the interactions that make life possible. Think of structural proteins like the car seat that supports the driver. The seat itself doesn't do much, but its shape and adjustment is critical to how comfortable the driver is when going about their day. Mutations in structural proteins sometimes change their shape. These misshapen proteins often can't make the same kinds of interactions as before. And in the worst case, this makes us sick. In our car analogy, a mutation might push the driver's seat all the way forwards into the steering wheel. Now, only smaller drivers would be able to use the car, larger drivers might miss Grad Slam. In my research, I'm working on a structural protein named P97 that is sometimes mutated in people. When a patient with this mutation reaches middle age, they experience rapid muscle loss and a tragic form of dementia where their personality slowly fades. At UCSF, we're working to stop this disease by designing a drug that can compensate for mutations and restore the normal binding between P97 and its partners, pushing the seat back, so to speak. To do this, I'm designing a version of P97 which is identical to the protein found in patients, except that it will change color just depending on its shape. Just by shining light at it, we'll be able to tell if the seat is pushed forwards or back. Then we can test thousands of potential drugs to see which ones help restore the normal shape. Unfortunately, coloring a tiny protein on the atomic scale isn't as easy as it sounds. I'm relying on a recently developed tool called click chemistry to label P97 with two dyes at specific locations on its structure. When these dyes are close, they emit red light. When they're far apart, they emit green light. This fascinating phenomenon has been nicknamed a molecular ruler because it can measure even nanometer changes in distance. Think of it like measuring the distance between the car seat and the steering wheel. Not only can this approach be used to help patients with mutated P97, but it could also be used for other proteins that are deformed by mutations. Hopefully, in the not so distant future, finding drugs for these kinds of genetic diseases will be as easy as adjusting your seat. Thank you.
The mood is right. I loved y'all's welcome and opening for Chad. Thank you for that. And I love the analogy, Chad. Excellent. So now, as the judges are judging, it's time for our trivia contest. Today's theme is simply San Francisco. We're going to see how knowledgeable you are about the city of San Francisco. For those of you who are viewing our event remotely, this will be like watching Jeopardy at home. I love Jeopardy. I watch it with my grandma. In other words, sorry, no prizes for you. You can just yell at the screen, and that's about it. But we hope you'll have fun guessing the answers anyway. For our live audience, please raise your hand if you think you know the answer. And obviously, no Googling on your cell phone, because I already told you you don't need to be on your phones, right? So we don't have audience mics today, so Dr. Ray Kerr in the Office of Career and Professional Development will there we go. All right. Get a little kudos. I'm loving it. We'll point to the first person who's raised their hand, and if it's you, say the answer loudly, and if you get the answer right, we'll give you a goodie bag. I know. That's one thing about Grad Slam, always giving out prizes. That's like my favorite thing, along with the talks, obviously. So we want to thank Campus Life Services for generously donating our trivia bag, which includes two different beverage containers plus a $20 fast pay card good at numerous campus vendors, so you can use it on campus. Once the question has been answered correctly, I will tell you some more fun facts in order to give our judges some time to evaluate the talk they just listened to. All right, our first trivia question. The question is, the U.S. Navy wanted the Golden Gate Bridge to be painted in black and yellow stripes, but it wound up being painted this iconic color. No. Excellent. Yes. So the Golden Gate Bridge was constructed between 1933 and 1937. The steel that arrived in San Francisco to build a bridge was coated in a burnt red and orange shade of primer to protect it from corrosive elements. The consulting architect preferred the vivid hue of the primer to a more conventional paint choice, such as carbon black and steel gray. Judges, do I need to keep going? Are we okay? Okay. You don't get any more facts. But no, that was a good one. When I first moved to San Francisco, my parents came to visit, and that's when I learned about International Orange on the double-decker tours. So I actually highly recommend it if you're interested. All right, let's move on. Our second speaker is Katrine Peterson. She is in the neuroscience PhD program. Her faculty advisors are Leonard Mukri and Ryan Corsis, and the title of her talk is Clustering, Giving Cell Types a Solo Performance.
When a choir sings, the voices of each singer come together to create something that is more than the sum of its parts, rich and complex, harmony. If even one person is off key, the discordant sound pervades the music, and this harmony is broken. Like a choir, the cells in our bodies are also an ensemble. They work in synchrony to maintain health and harmony within. So if an injury or disease compromises even just one type of cell, it can have far-reaching effects across the entire body. This is especially apparent in diseases like Parkinson's, where loss of dopamine neurons in the brain disrupts the entire network of cells that conduct our body's movement. To learn how to stop this disruption, we first have to be able to separate out the vulnerable cells from the rest. And we can, with the help of single-cell sequencing, which gives us a snapshot, or shall we say, a soundbite, of thousands, even millions of cells. But now, to sort through all this data, we have to be able to group cells into distinct types, just as we might group singers into sopranos, altos, or baritones. And many methods have been developed to group cells into clusters based on their sequencing information. But they often fail to distinguish nuances between, say, different types of neurons in the brain, or they may even hallucinate new cell types purely out of noise in the data. They also largely rely on manual, somewhat arbitrary tuning and curation that can burn through many hours of a grad student's life. So I've developed an alternative, a new statistically grounded clustering method that uses machine learning to determine which sets of cells truly represent biologically distinct cell types. I've tested this method on all sorts of data, from the brain, the blood, even cancer cells, to make sure that in every scenario, it can identify even the rarest cell types. Using this method, we can be confident that each cell type gets its solo performance, allowing us to pick out those off-key singers that are so critical to our understanding of diseases like Parkinson's, but might otherwise have been obscured in background noise. Without this highly mechanistic insight into each cell type, we simply won't know what needs to be corrected through treatments in order to restore harmony. So, to pay homage to our body's harmonies, these intricate, synchronous systems, I decided to name our method Choir. Thank you.
Thank you, Katrine. I love your images. I'm very visual, so this is quite beautiful. Thank you. Our next trivia question. Be ready?
Yeah.
I'll wait for folks to settle in, actually, if that's all right. If everyone can find a seat really quickly, that would be great, and we'll continue on. All right, the question is, this moody Hitchcock movie classic filmed in San Francisco features scenes at Fort Point, the Legion of Honor, and Mission Dolores, among many others. Yes. So So some related facts about Vertigo. It was released in 1958, starring James Stewart and Kim Novak, and featured dozens of San Francisco filming locations. It's now considered Alfred Hitchcock's masterpiece and one of the first films selected for the U.S. National Film Registry. Mm. Did y'all know that? Did anyone know that? I love the trivia too, because I'm always like, wow, I'm learning a lot. The movie's dramatic opening shows a police chase over Knob Hill rooftops. The neighborhood features prominently in the rest of the film too, as it's where Kim Novak's character Madeline lives. Knob Hill was where California's 19th century railroad barons built their extravagant mansions. Judges, we still need more time? I think so. Okay, I'm gonna keep going. Vertigo premiered in San Francisco on May 9th, 1958 at the Stage Door Theater at Mason and Geary. It's now called the August Hall Nightclub. Has anyone been there? Yeah? Oh, it's cool. Okay. Decades later, in October 1996, the restored print of Vertigo debuted in San Francisco with a live onstage introduction by Kim Novak, providing the city a chance to celebrate itself. The event took place at the Castro Theater, itself a famed San Francisco landmark. And I know it's under reconstruction right now. Okay. Yes. Judges, are we ready to move forward? All right. Our third speaker, Cindy Williams. Sydney is in the Pharmaceutical Sciences Pharmacogenomics PhD program. Her faculty advisor is Aparna Lakaraju, and the title of Sydney's talk is RABS, Delivery Drivers of the Eye.
My dad has been working as a delivery driver for UPS for over 20 years. Hi, Dad. He works tirelessly to ensure that our packages make it to us no matter where we are. But what happens if my dad doesn't make the deliveries? Well, for us, that means no new packages. But for our eyes, that could mean irreversible blindness. You see, I study a particular cell type called the RPE, which stands for the retinal pigment epithelium. The RPE is a thin single layer of cells in the back of our eye. Its job is to protect our retina, and it does so by forming tight and secure connections between neighboring cells. These connections form somewhat of a barrier around our retina, so when they break down, it can lead to macular degeneration, a common form of irreversible blindness where patients lose their central vision. To establish these connections, our RPE uses a delivery system similar to UPS, where the materials needed to build these connections are driven and delivered to specific destinations in the cell by a group of proteins known as RAB GTPases. But since I can't say that five times fast, I'm just gonna call them RABs. Now, there are over 60 RABs in the human body, yet no one knows which are responsible for maintaining those connections between RPE cells. But don't worry, that's why I'm here. You see, I've identified a small group of RAB proteins who, when they break down and their delivery routes go haywire, connections between RPE cells break down, causing that irreversible blindness. But luckily, I found a novel drug that improves RAB function. This drug has helped me understand how to redirect RABs to their proper destination and reestablish those RPE connections. To explore this, I began by collecting eye samples from patients, then performing high-resolution imaging of the living retina using a very powerful microscope. And using computer programs, I created 3D images that show the movement of specific RAB proteins. Using this microscopy, I've been able to see how RABs deliver RPE connections, how RAB proteins go awry in blindness, and I've discovered that when RABs and connections are disrupted, there's a drug that can restore them. So in summary, I've uncovered mechanisms for which our RPE needs to maintain those connections for our vision. And I found a drug to treat irreversible blindness. Even better, it's already FDA approved. So we can take it to the clinic sooner. So in life, remember to wave to your local delivery drivers. Like my dad, they do way more than meets the eye. Thank you.
Thank you, Sydney, and I love the signs. This is great up here, and I love the fact that you brought in your dad. And I actually studied visual neuroscience in my postdoc, so these images I know very well. All right, so our next trivia question. Are we ready for more trivia? Okay, so the question is, Juana Briones de Miranda, a 19th century Mexican-American merchant, healer, and landowner, is called the founding mother of San Francisco. But what was San Francisco called when she first lived here? Yes, sis. So Donna Juana Briones de Miranda lived from 1802 to 1889 and lived in the San Francisco Bay Area under the flags of three different nations. She was one of the first three settlers in Yerba Buena before it became San Francisco. It is unclear just when Briones moved to an adobe farmhouse in what is now known as North Beach. According to her biographer, she may have done so as early as 1826. That would have made her the first resident of the hamlet of Yerba Buena. I'm gonna keep going with some of the facts. I'm glad that we can laugh, and I'm loving this exchange, just so you know. So Briones was an extraordinary woman in many ways. She left her abusive husband, opened a dairy ranch in what is now Washington Square. Ooh, I love Washington Square. I haven't been there in a while. Selling milk and vegetables to the crews of visiting ships and serving as a nurse and midwife to the growing community. She did everything. That's what we do in our community, right? She was a healer. She used herbs and other natural ingredients that she learned about from her mother and from indigenous people. Again, that's what we do with the spiritual connection. Judges, am I able to move forward with the next contestant? Excellent. Our fourth speaker, Olivia Barnhill. Olivia is a student in the neuroscience PhD program. Her faculty advisor is Dr. Alexandra Nelson. And the title of her talk is Lights, Camera, Stimulation.
As we physically navigate our world, our brains initiate and pattern our muscle movements. Consider how you even walked into this auditorium. In order not to walk like Frankenstein, you had to alternate flexing and relaxing both your hamstrings and your quadricep muscles. But that effortless precision in which some of us can enter this auditorium is probably most evident in those who can no longer perform these types of actions due to movement disorders. And one common form of these disorders is called dystonia. And patients with dystonia experience these incredibly rigid postures and twisting involuntary movements that can be just incredibly disabling. And for most of these patients, there's really only one major treatment that seems to work for them, and that's deep brain stimulation. Now, deep brain stimulation is a treatment that involves surgically implanting a stimulator deep into the brain where electrical pulses are delivered 24/7, and somehow that seems to work for them. But despite decades of employing this life-changing technique, scientists still don't understand how it works. Does activity in the brain go up? Does it go down? We really actually don't know. Part of the problem is that we can't actually look deep into the brains of these humans. But without understanding how deep brain stimulation works, it leaves us unable to develop therapies that don't involve that incredibly invasive brain surgery. So that's where my research comes in. We have mice that have the same form of dystonia that some of our human patients have. And my lab also specifically designed a wearable deep brain stimulation device that sits on top of the mouse's head like a little hat and delivers that same high-frequency stimulation deep into their brains. And just like we see with our human patients, those mice go from rigid postures to easy, fluid movements. But how do I actually look deep into the brain in these mice while deep brain stimulation is happening? Well, our brain has these cells called neurons, and they transmit information like messengers. I put a specialized marker into these cells so that every time it sends information, I see a flash of light. And I can actually see these flashing neurons because I implant a tiny camera into the brain to actually image that brain activity. So now we can actually see what's happening in the brain while using that therapeutic deep brain stimulation. With this research, I hope that we can develop these less invasive strategies using these lights and cameras. We're hoping to get dystonia patients take back control of their actions. Thank you.
Thank you, Olivia. I know you have a lot of excellent hand-eye coordination with your surgeries on these mice. So our next trivia question is, this famed author and civil rights activist received the National Medal of Freedom from President Obama and is featured on a U.S. quarter. She was also a San Francisco streetcar conductor in her youth. Who is it? Yes, it is Maya Angelou. So Maya Angelou was one of the first female streetcar conductors in San Francisco as a teenager during World War II. In her autobiography, I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings, she writes of deciding to take a semester off from George Washington High School in the fall of 1943, where she was a year ahead, and get work experience. She knew the streetcar companies were hiring women and, quote, and thought, quote, and the thought of sailing up and down the hills of San Francisco in a dark blue uniform with a money changer at my belt caught my fancy. When they snubbed her the first day she tried to apply, she grew determined. Encouraged by her mother, she said she went back every day for 2 weeks until they finally let her fill out an application. She started with her correct legal name at the time, Marguerite Johnson, but then put her age as 19. A monument to Angelou is set to be unveiled in fall 2024 outside the San Francisco Main Public Library, right down the street from here, Mission Bay. It is intended to honor one of the most significant literary artists and activists of our time, and will be an ever-present role model and inspiration to us all, especially girls and young women. So, excellent. Learn something new. Judges, ready to move forward? Okie doke. Our fifth speaker, Rachel Rock. Rachel is biomedical sciences PhD program student in the biomedical science PhD program, Her faculty advisor is Dr. Peter Turnbaugh. And the title of her talk is Gut Microbes in Mind, Exploring One Potential Reason Why Women Are More Likely to Suffer from Autoimmune Disease.
Pants with pockets in the front. And over 80% of those affected with autoimmune disease are women. Yet the usual suspects for sex bias, genetics, and hormones are insufficient to explain why so many more women than men suffer from autoimmune disease. So, what could be behind this? Well, maybe it's just what my lab studies, the collection of microbes living inside of the human gut. Okay, but what microbes matter? There are thousands of microbial species known to colonize the human gut, and thousands of microbes means millions of potential mechanisms. How can we get any closer to a solution? Because one microbe can matter a lot. just as with people. Walt Disney, Mahatma Gandhi, Queen Bee Beyoncé! And each of you, in the context of your own lives, one can really matter. Okay, but back to the science. I wanted to see if microbes more abundant in women could have anything to do with autoimmune disease. So, what did I find? Leveraging a database with more than 20,000 samples, prevalent human gut bacteria E. lenta emerged as the top hit for a female-enriched species. This was a striking result. Human gut bacteria E. lenta has been associated with a slew of autoimmune conditions, including rheumatoid arthritis, inflammatory bowel disease, and even the autoimmune brain disease, multiple sclerosis. For my PhD, I was ready to go bold or go home and answer the question of if this female-enriched human gut microbe, E. lenta, could drive a mouse model of the autoimmune brain disease, multiple sclerosis. My results were striking. Mice that were given E. lenta in control media versus control media only experienced a full point difference in disease score. These mice were, on average, experiencing complete hind limb paralysis, dragging themselves across the floor of the cage. Well, aside from a bit of wobble in their step and a droopy tail, the controls were totally fine. I'm still working to figure out how exactly E. lenta makes immune cells tick in multiple sclerosis. I'm excited to have discovered that a gut microbe more common in women is one potential reason why women are more likely to suffer autoimmune disease. And with that, one small microbe can make a big difference, just as would real pockets on women's pants. Thank you.
And Rachel, we should have coffee because I study multiple sclerosis in grad school. So I needed your research then. Okay, our next trivia question. Are we ready? All right. The question is, in 1957, the New York Giants moved to San Francisco to become the San Francisco Giants. What was the original name of the franchise in New York City?
The New York Giants?
No. I love the confidence, though, Miguel. I love it. This one's kind of hard. You want some clues? So this was a movie when, what's this dude's name? What are these dudes? Michael Keaton and Christian Bates was in. There's a hand up over here, Ray. Can you add some words together? Yay, yes. In New York Gothams, yes. So, I know, right? There's some wobbling about the name, like, that doesn't even sound right. So, the Gothams were founded in New York in 1883, and with 62 games in 1884. Then, with the name change to the Giants in 1885, they went 85-27 that season under manager Jim Mutri. At the end of the 1957 season in New York, the Giants packed up and moved to California to start the 1958 season. Ruben Gomez threw the first pitch on opening day starter on April 15, 1958 at Seal Stadium in San Francisco and shut out the LA Dodgers in an 8-0 complete game victory. I know. Seal Stadium was on the corner of 16th and Bryant where the Safeway Shopping Center now stands. Whoa, really? Was anybody else shocked by that? Okay, cool. The Giants played there for the first season in San Francisco before the opening of Candlestick Park. Those who grew up here, y'all went to Candlestick Park? Okay. Where the Giants played until moving to their current home in 2000. I'm out of facts. So are we okay to move on, judges? Excellent. Our sixth speaker is Ruben Hogan. Woo! Ruben is in the biophysics PhD program and medical scientist training program. His faculty advisor is Dr. Nevin Krogan, and the title of his talk is Protein Folding is Pretty Sweet.
You know, I never really met nobody who was truly successful that wasn't thankful for the good and the bad.
When you think of something sugary, what do you see? Probably something edible, right? We're all familiar with the idea that sugar is necessary for energy. But what if I told you that sugars have other important roles inside the cell, beyond energy? In fact, sugars can be attached to proteins in a cellular process that's intentional. Why? Well, most of the time it's to help a protein fold so that it can reach its proper shape for its proper function. Your next question is probably how. Who here has been to IKEA? When you go to IKEA to purchase a table, you want that table to look the exact same way it did in the store, right? And to ensure that, IKEA has factories that are responsible for producing table parts to consistent metrics every time. And they have checkpoints where they regularly assess the quality of those table parts. And you might even imagine that there's a QR code associated with that table that reads all that information out. In this example, the QR code is our sugar. By reading the structure of the sugar, nearby proteins that are assisting in folding are able to understand whether to keep the attached protein or to scrap it. This process is so fundamental, it's used in almost every cell of our bodies and on over half of the proteins produced by our genes. In fact, we think this process may underlie diseases that we see today. For example, many of you may be familiar with Alzheimer's disease, a condition that affects 1 in 9 of individuals over the age of 65. It has long been known that this is a disease characterized by 2 misfolded proteins. But despite that knowledge, there are no diagnostic tests, and our treatment options are modest at best. So, what do? By using a special instrument called a mass spectrometer, we're able to read those sugary QR codes to try and understand whether the attached protein is folding well or not. In this way, we can monitor cells to understand what events trigger misfolding. To go back to our factory analogy, it's as though we can see what part of the assembly line is maybe failing and potentially even understand how to fix it. Getting this right could mean a large step forward in a disease that has already robbed so many people of their memories, their personalities, and their lives. Thank you.
I love the IKEA analogy, Ruben, and I have to say I've outgrown IKEA. Has anyone gone to the IKEA store downtown? I went in there the other day and I said I've outgrown it. So, our next trivia question. What did one Philo T. Farnsworth invent in 1927 in a simple laboratory at 202 Green Street in San Francisco?
Do they need all this?
Can you be a little bit more detailed? Okay, it's cool. So the answer is the first electronic TV. So that's, thank you. So some facts about this trivia question. So the landmark plaque at the Green Street address says that says in a simple laboratory on this site, 202 Green Street, Philo Taylor Farnsworth, U.S. pioneer in electronics, invented and patented the first operational all-electronic television system on September 7th, 1927. The 21-year-old inventor and several dedicated assistants successfully transmitted the first all-electronic television image, the major breakthrough that brought the practical form of this invention to mankind. Further patents formulated here cover the basic concepts essential to modern television. The genius of Green Street, also as he was known, died in 1971. Farnsworth held 300 patents, mostly in radio and television. His inventions contributed to the development of radar, infrared, night vision devices, the electron microscope, I know many of you use that in this room, the baby incubator, the gastroscope, and the astronomical telescope. Pretty big deal. Are we ready to move forward, judges? Okay. Our seventh speaker is Naz Dundar. Naz is in the neuroscience PhD program. Her faculty advisor is Dr. Zachary Knight, and the title of her talk is The Hidden Hunger Hormone.
Have some more chicken, have some more pie. It doesn't matter if it's boiled or fried. Just eat it, just eat it, just eat it.
Broadly speaking, I'm fascinated by this one simple question. To eat or not to eat? We all have the experience of deciding to stop eating that seems to be guided by our free will. Yet we also all have that one pint of ice cream that we somehow always end up finishing in one sitting. As you can see, it's Ben & Jerry's strawberry cheesecake for me. What most of us don't realize is that our brains need to integrate a variety of signals to evaluate our appetite. Widely studied examples of such signals include the smell of food to hormones secreted by our gut. However, many don't really appreciate that our appetite is also regulated by signals that you might not initially associate with hunger. And one of these signals is the sex hormone, estrogen. Although the effect of estrogen on food intake remains very much understudied, about half the people in this room can tell you that their appetite is regulated by estrogen on a daily basis. Simply put, estrogen signaling in our brains causes a decrease in our appetites. And accordingly, those who menstruate see changes in their appetites that reflect changes in their blood estrogen levels. On the other hand, declining estrogen levels during menopause are associated with increased food intake and weight gain. With my thesis work, I first set out to show that during their version of the menstrual cycle, mice also experience similar changes in their appetites. Being able to replicate this effect in mice allowed me to now focus on investigating how estrogen affects the satiety centers of our brains. In my following experiments, I showed that estrogen regulates brain cells that are responsible for promoting fullness after a meal. Oh no. I messed it up. I'm gonna end my speech right there, but thank you so much for listening to me.
This is on, okay, now it's on. Okay, there we go. Our next trivia question, number 7. The question is, in 1906, what caused more damage than the earthquake?
Fire.
We didn't even see a hand up. All I heard was a voice coming from this direction. Yes, it was the fire after the earthquake. Thank you over here. I appreciate you. So some related facts. It has been estimated that up to 90% of the total destruction was the result of the subsequent fires. Within 3 days, over 30 fires caused by ruptured gas mains destroyed approximately 25,000 buildings on 490 city blocks. The fires cost an estimated $350 million at the time, equivalent to $8.5 billion in 2022. Leaking gas was the catalyst for fires that quickly spread throughout the city, and the lack of water made firefighting a clear challenge. Approximately one hour after the earthquake, the San Francisco Fire Department sent a message to the Presidio to request an artillery division to assist with the containment of fires. Several hours later, artillery troops from Fort Milley arrived in San Francisco and unsuccessfully attempted to control the fires by dynamiting strategic buildings. By noon, the financial district was engulfed in flames. And when evening fell, the city center had been also incinerated. I don't know what to say, because that I can feel the heaviness in the room. Everybody else did too, right? So again, that's why it's important to know your history. Just put it into context with what you see in front of you. Judges, are we okay to move on? All right, excellent. Our eighth speaker, Ilena Bayou Grossman, who is in the bioengineering PhD program. Okay, I love it. Her faculty advisor is Edward Chang, and the title of her talk is The Magic of Language Understanding. What's he trying to say?
You speak my language. There are over 7,000 languages spoken in the world today. Think about a language that you don't know. Think about how it sounds. You might recognize some of those sounds from your own language, like the vowel sound ah, or the consonant sound s. But what might be tricky is grouping these sounds together into the words that they belong to. This is in part because, despite what you might think, in natural speech, there are no clear pauses between words. In fact, there is no reliable sound cues that tell you how to group sounds into words at all. But when you're listening to a language that you can understand, this fact poses no problem for you. Those vowel and consonant sounds magically assemble, shoop, into words that now carry meaning. So how is it that you're able to so easily group sounds into words in languages that you know? What changes when speech means something to you versus when it doesn't? I study these questions by looking at the human brain. Our lab has the unique opportunity to work with patients whose brains are being monitored by very small electrical sensors that a neurosurgeon places underneath their skull directly onto their brain surface. These patients, who have many different language backgrounds, graciously volunteer to help out with my research by listening to speech in their native language and a language that they don't know. While they do this, my lab mates and I observe the neural activity going on in their brains. And excitingly, I found that you can tell when someone's listening to their native language by looking at their brain activity. How? Well, you look at moments when one word ends and another begins, also known as a word boundary. When you listen to speech you can understand, word boundaries are effortlessly identified. You're doing it right now as you listen to me speak. And as it turns out, when I used machine learning models to analyze the signals of the brain, I found that your brain is helping you to do this by tracking where word boundaries are in speech, but only when you understand the language that you're listening to. So we concluded that one ingredient to language understanding is our brains figuring out when words end and begin. This is a major step in demystifying the magic that allows us to understand spoken language. And it's also an important reminder that when we encounter something that our brain does that feels magical, we can pull back the curtain to reveal the complicated and fascinating work being done behind the scenes to make it all happen. Thank you.
Thank you, Ilena. Our next trivia question. Where did the Beatles play their last paid concert? Yes. Candlestick Park, yes. Thank you. So although they made an unannounced live appearance in January 1969 on the rooftop of the Apple Building, the Beatles' final concert took place on August 29, 1966 at Candlestick Park in San Francisco. The arena's capacity was more than 42,000, but only 25,000 tickets were sold. Many didn't know this would be the Fab Four's last performance. Fans at the time paid between $4.50 and $6.50. Right. Just a fun side fact, I used to live in Nashville before I moved here, and for those, anyone from Nashville? Okay. and so, you know, it's the music city of the country, right? And so I took advantage of all the concerts there, so tickets were super cheap, and all the artists used to come there. And so, like, for Beyonce, some of you probably paid $300, $400. I saw Beyonce for $100, more than once, right? So when I saw this statistic, I was like, $450? Woo, this is serious to see the Beatles so iconic. So the Beatles fee was around $90,000. So the group knew it was their final concert. Recognizing its significance, John Lennon and Paul McCartney took a camera on the stage, with which they took pictures of the crowd, the rest of the group, and themselves at arm's length to capture the moment. So they already knew. Judges, are we okay? Okay. Our ninth speaker, Lorenzo Del Castillo. Lorenzo is in the Tetrad PhD program. Their faculty advisor is Dr. Jeremy Ryder, and the title of their talk is Shining Some Light on Sonic Hedgehog Signaling. And the Jay-Z song was lost, so I put my hand.
In the beginning, we were all one, newly fertilized cell. And this single cell will go through a multitude of drastic changes that will eventually result in complex beings, like everyone sitting here today. And it's important that everything go according to plan, so that all of you are able to be here. Now, during development, these drastic changes that the cell will go through are coordinated by several signals. And it is the precise coordination of these signals that result in proper setup of the body. One of these signals that I'm very interested in is called Sonic Hedgehog. And yes, that's the name. Not only is Sonic Hedgehog an important player in making many of our body parts, like our hands for one example, but the activity of Sonic Hedgehog is important in distinguishing between different outcomes within a distinct body part, like the different fingers of our hands. Now, we know a lot about how Sonic works, and we know that the amount or the concentration is important in distinguishing between these different possible outcomes. In the example of our hands, a high concentration of signal is required to make our pinkies, a low concentration of signal is required to make our thumbs, with a gradient of signal forming everything in between. So concentration is the only factor, end of story, right? Well, not really. We used to think that the concentration a cell received meant everything, but during development, time is passing. What does it mean when cells are exposed to not only different concentrations of sonic, but for different durations as well? That's what I want to know, what I'm here to figure out. There's even some evidence that shows that when cells are exposed to one specific concentration of sonic for longer durations, they can specify a few different outcomes. Again, hinting that duration is playing some role here. So how can I precisely address the matter of duration? Well, I have some pretty cool tools I've been working on that should help me with that. One of these tools is a protein, and it's light activated. When light is shined on this protein, it basically acts like a brake in the pathway to stop or slow down signal activity. With this tool in cells, I can precisely control the duration of sonic hedgehog activity like never before, all with the flip of a switch. So far, some of my recent results show that a short pulse of signal can even increase overall activation over a continuous signal, which I was not expecting. With the work I'm doing here at UCSF, I hope to shine some light on how this one fundamental player, Sonic Hedgehog, can choose the right outcome out of many, each and every time. And the more we know about how it all works out properly, the better we can get at fixing it when it all goes wrong. Thank you.
Thank you, Lorenzo. And just so you know, in this part of the room, as at one part during your 3-minute talk, I heard a lot of So things really click with this side of the room. I'm having so much fun up here, and I'm loving the last two. Are you ready, Ray? Okay, our next trivia question. In June 2023, the wild parrot was named San Francisco's official animal. Name two other animals that were among the 8 finalists in the popular vote. I didn't know this one. So I have like eight names on here. You can just randomly say some stuff. Oh, how'd you? Sea lions and coyotes. Hold on, can you stand up? I need to see who said that. Oh, Victoria. Thank you. So yes, so the acceptable answers are coyote, crabs, sea lions, bison, Mission Blue Butterfly, San Francisco Garter Snake, Claude the Albino Alligator. Okay, this is stimulating. This is really stimulating for you all. What are we thinking? Can I get some feedback about this question? Yes, Michael. Michael said, where did the alligator come from? I don't know. So let me share some more related facts so we can all learn from these questions. After more than 27,000 people voted in 4 rounds, the wild parrots were named champions, beating out sea lions with 51.3% of the vote. I'm surprised they beat out the sea lions, though, because people come from across the world. Huh? What'd you say? You voted for the conure. You voted for who? Oh, you voted for the bird?
Yeah.
Oh. Why? This side of the room is hitting tonight, okay? Do I need to give some more facts, judges? Okay, cool. Let's move on, because we spent a lot of time on this question. Okay, and now for our final speaker, Simone Creel. Thank you. Simone is in the Biomedical Sciences PhD program. Her faculty advisor is Dr. Holger Willenbring, and the title for talk is If You Can't Arboretum, Join Them, Growing the Biliary Tree from Scratch.
Are you working? What kind of work do you do? What is it you want?
When I see a tree without leaves in the winter, its intricate branching architecture reminds me of a similar, much smaller tree that looks just like that. But the tree I'm thinking of is actually inside of your liver. The biliary tree, as depicted on the right, is an arboreal network of tubes that stretches to the edges of your liver lobe and drains bile, a metabolic waste product, from your liver into the intestine. However, if the biliary tree is absent or not fully formed, then the bile can't drain, causing extensive tissue damage and eventually organ failure. My focus is a disease affecting the very formation of this biliary tree called Alagille syndrome. Children born with this condition have biliary trees that are absent or severely truncated, and 3/4 of these patients will require a liver transplant by the age of 20. But what if, instead of relying on a liver transplant, we could regrow the biliary tree from the inside? To do this, we turn to a phenomenon observed in our laboratory. We use a mouse model of Alagille syndrome that mimics the human disease. So our mice are similarly born without biliary trees, as depicted on the left. But here is where I must reveal a small secret. Because the fully fledged biliary tree you see depicted on the right is actually from this exact same kind of mouse that was born without any biliary tree at all. Unlike humans, this mouse can spontaneously generate a biliary tree equivalent to a normal mouse. Surprisingly, we found that just as a seed completely transforms in order to become a tree, the primary liver cell type, called a hepatocyte, completely transforms its cell identity, fate, and function in order to generate the biliary tree. Now, in my role as a gardener scientist, I'm unearthing the mechanism behind this. By isolating individual cells of the biliary tree at discrete stages of its development. Using computational tools, I can visualize how the genes expressed by these cells fluctuate over time. So far, I've identified the genes responsible not only for the change in cell identity, but also the structural change in the size, shape, and organization of the biliary tree branches. Right now, I'm testing to see if I can accelerate this process by delivering the genes I identified to the seed of the biliary tree itself, the hepatocyte. If successful, this approach represents a tangible strategy for inducing, directing, and maintaining the growth of this essential structure in humans. Thank you.
So Simone, I think that Grey's Anatomy might owe you some money, because as you were talking, I thought about one of the episodes where with the mini livers. Yeah. Y'all know what I'm talking about? Is this Simone's research? That's what I'm talking about. Yes. So we don't have any more trivia questions. That was the end. Thank you, Ray, for your assistance. I know. Do we have any more prizes, though? No more prizes? Okay. See, I'm still trying to get you things. You see how I do? So I'd like to invite all of the finalists back up to the stage. I'm just waiting for the pictures to finish. I got some more words to say. Thank you. So thank you all so much for educating us, entertaining us. Excellent job, each and every one of you. Thank you. You can go back to your seats, yes. This is also our audience chance to play judge today. I know. We got some, a little bit of power today, huh? So we feeling good, I see. Vote for your favorite talk to win the People's Choice Award by going to the URL or QR code that will be displayed on the screen momentarily. Oh, okay, in a little bit, okay. Those of you viewing remotely will also see this link right under the video in your browser or in the description area below the video on YouTube. You may, just a little bit of note, you may need to refresh your browser to see it. You can take a minute to think about it, but please vote soon. Audience voting will only be open for 5 minutes. I know, you gotta make your decision quick. While the judges are whisked away to a top secret location to confer and decide on today's winners, please take a short break and stretch your legs. We have some light refreshments out in the atrium, and we want you to come back. This is not an opportunity to get on the shuttle wherever you're going home. We need you back in the seats, because we got to hear who the winners are, right? At about 5:25, we will reconvene here to announce the winners, and those who are online, you can watch the announcement remotely. It's been a pleasure serving as your MC. Thank you.
All right, are you guys ready to cheer? That's what I'm talking about. All right. I always forget to do this, so I'm just going to do it now. This event takes a lot of planning, a lot. There are some really great people who worked tirelessly over the last few months to make this happen, and I just want to pause and recognize them in this moment. So first of all, let's thank those guys who worked tirelessly to be able to present for 3 minutes of their lives. 3 minutes. But they had coaches, and they had screening judges, and they had finalist judges to get to this point. So I just want to thank both the screening judges and the final judges. I don't know if any of them are in the room, but if you are, just give them a shout out. If they're not, I bet you they're listening. They also had coaches, right? So coaches helped them to get where they were. So shout out to the coaches for me. And how many of you know about our OCPD? There we go. So I see David, I see Ray, I see who else is in here? Lydia? There you go. I see Lydia. So please, big shout out to the R team. For OCPD. These ETS guys in the back, no one ever knows they're there unless something goes wrong. Well, they're there. Nothing went wrong. They're there. Thank you very much. To our Campus Life Services, who provided the bags for today, and of course, to the GradDiv staff, people who don't normally come in are here today just to serve you. So please join me in thanking everyone that participated in making this possible. All right, I'm done. Now for what you're really here for. It's time to announce our awardees, and I have to tell you, today is historic. It is historic. So the judges had a hard time in making a decision, and we went the statistical method in making a decision. So what you are about to hear is history making. Let us start with the People's Award. This is the award that you voted for. Going to ask, who's doing the People's Award? Erin, to come. I will hand her the envelope. Drum roll, please. And the winner is
Sydney Williams.
All right, so there is no money in that, just so you know. But money will magically appear in your account at some point in time. All right, so the People's Award, that was $750. What did we say that did? Yeah. And now for the history. It turns out that there was a tie. There was a third place tie. And don't tell my business manager this, but I made the executive decision to hand out $2,000 prizes for third place. So, So I only have one envelope, but there are two people who are about to win. So I'm going to ask Rainey and Laura to come, and you will each announce your own winners. $1,000. Drum roll, please.
So do we open the same envelope twice?
No, no, just open that and then you can pass it. It's all right.
All right, third place. The first third place winner is Ruben Hogan.
Money will show up, Ruben. Money will show up. Don't worry.
Our second, third place winner is Sydney Williams.
All right. Thank you both. I will take that. And you will get money. Now remember, you can't tell my business manager. Okay, just remember that. You can't tell my business manager. All right. Second place prize in the amount of $2,000 will be presented by Kristen Hackett. And drum roll, please.
And the winner is Simone Curiel.
Well done. The first place winner, who will also represent UCSF at the system-wide Grad Slam, and who will earn, in a moment, $4,000? Drum roll, please, and Brian.
All right. And the award goes to Elena Baia Grossman.
Now, you guys can feel free to come down and take pictures with your labs, with your people. All of you did a fantastic job. Thank you for entertaining us and educating us today. I just want to call out one special person. This dude spends his whole life for about 3 months organizing the event, working with the students, working on the trivia questions. The man knows history like you wouldn't believe. So please join me in thanking Eric Rothman. He is somewhere around here. Come here, Eric. Come here, Eric. There you go. There you go. Excellent. Thank you all so very much for showing up today. Clearly you had a good time. Don't have to ask. Clearly you had a good time. And I hope you enjoy the rest of Grad Student Appreciation Week. Thank you all so much.